Welcome everyone. My name is Gábor Rétvári. I'm from the Budapest University of Technology and Economics, and I'm also with Ericsson Research. And this is joint work with Gianni and Tiki from Queen Mary, London. Let me start with a quick disclaimer. So, as you might be aware of, this year SOSR, besides regular research contributions, also invited so-called challenge papers, which are supposed to be position papers that outline the next steps and the big challenges ahead of software-defined networking. Now, this is such a challenge paper, so please don't expect us to provide answers here, because we do not have them. What we have is a couple of questions, and we hope that you will find these questions interesting. Here is the executive summary of this talk. In the networking community, we are kind of trained to this traditional view of network devices that intermediate nodes in the network process network traffic only at the lower three layers of the protocol stack. Ethernet bridges that traditionally handle packets at layer 2, IP routers at layer 3 or network layer processing capability, and middle boxes recently have started to add sophisticated layer 4 or transport layer processing capability to our intermediate nodes. Think of, for instance, network address translations or translation or stateful firewalls. The idea in software-defined networking then is to separate the control plane functionalities out from these intermediate nodes and unify them at a central and centralized SDN controller, because this makes it possible to define, to administer, and to impose link layer, network layer, and to a limited extent, transport layer network policies from a central authority. We argue, however, that this traditional view of SDN should be revisited, because this is too much restricted to these lower three layers of the protocol stack, and we should start to think about extending SDN all the way up into the application layer. So envision an extended SDN that can provide network processing functionalities at all layers of the protocol stack. We call this new SDN the so-called full-stack SDN architecture, and we call for further research in the area. And basically that's all. Thank you very much for attention. But not really. We are going to make the case for full-stack SDN through three important takeaways. The first is related to the way we deploy applications into the cloud. The traditional way of doing that, the so-called cloud 1.0 model, is to package monolithic applications into virtual machines and then deploy these virtual machines into the cloud. Such a monolithic application contains all the applications, libraries, and all the functionality and all the bells and whistles that's necessary to run the application. In this model, the virtual machines communicate over layer 2 and layer 3 protocols, so the low-level network virtualization service that is provided into our SDN is pretty much satisfactory in this context. We are currently witnessing a very fast transition from this cloud 1.0 model to a new model that we could call cloud 2.0, which is based around microservices. In this microservice architecture, the applications are finely grained, are decomposed in a very, very fine-grained manner into individual microservices. These microservices implement just one important functionality of the business logic of the application, and the application itself is then architected from these microservices and the communication protocols between them. Think of a microservice as a network function in the network function virtualization framework. This is basically just the same, but microservices are much more general than network function virtualization. Microservices are then deployed into Linux containers, which are then fired up at the virtual machines that we have in the cloud. One important observation here is that the dominant network pattern, the network communication pattern that we see in the microservice architecture, is no longer layer 2 and layer 3 protocols like in the cloud 1.0 model. But since each microservice implements some specific application layer functionality, the dominant network communication pattern is now over application layer protocol. And this brings us to our first important takeaway, that with the transition of the cloud deployment models to the microservice architecture, the main communication pattern that we see in our networks is more and more shifted towards application layer protocols. Let's take a look at how we build microservice applications in currently. This is a particular model that I took from a production microservice. This is basically a network function that processes packets and traffic from one virtual port to the other. This particular way of building microservices builds on a kernel bypass technique like RDMA or DPDK, and since DPDK applications usually send and receive packets at the Ethernet layer, the application itself must contain a full-fledged network protocol stack from the layer, from the link layer all the way up to the network layer, the transport layer, and the application layer processing as well. On top of this full network stack, we have the application logic, which essentially realizes the main functionality of the application. Now, why this is a problem? Because in this case, we have the layers, the critical layer 7 network policies, and the network functions are hard-coded into the applications, which causes a major problems when we try to impose layer 7 networking policies from a central place, like we usually do this in the SDN world for lower layer network functions. Imagine, for instance, load balancers. In this particular example, the layer 7 load balancer is engineered right into the application, which makes it particularly difficult to transition this microservice from a somewhat simple equal cost multipass load balancer to a more elaborate load balancer that might implement sticky sessions or adaptive load balancing. I'm going to just provide three simple examples where we believe that we intend to demonstrate why we believe that the network should be able to gain application layer insight into network traffic. Think of, for instance, this simple setup where a microservice exposes a read-only HTTP RESTful API to another microservice. So in this particular setup, we must be able to somehow impose the following layer 7 network policy on network traffic. We must be able to allow HTTP GET requests to be issued from our querying microservice to the read-only microservice, because these usually HTTP GET requests in the RESTful APIs usually implement read access to the API, but we must be able to deny HTTP POST access between these two microservices, because these usually are used to modify state. Now, in order to implement the read-only access, we must be able to somehow differentiate between these two types of calls and make an HTTP-specific decision whether we allow or we deny the particular connection request to get through. Now, the problem with the traditional layer 2 and layer 4 vision of SDN is that for an SDN switch, for an intermediate node that processes packets from the link layer, the network layer, and the transport layer, there is no way to differentiate between HTTP requests. So an HTTP GET and an HTTP POST call looks just the same for a traditional SDN switch, which basically makes it impossible to implement these types of layer 7 ACLs right into the virtual layer, network layer. This way, we usually need to resort to implementing ACLs right into the applications, but then it makes it particularly difficult to change or at least to verify these policies from a central authority. In another model, which is modeled after a common practice in continuous integration and continuous delivery circles, we try to test a new version, a developer version of a microservice alongside the production version of our microservice in our actual production cluster. This setup is usually called a canary deployment setup, where the test version of the microservice is deployed alongside the microservice, the production version of the microservice, and the way we test it is that we route test traffic to it, and then we observe its behavior. In this particular example, normal traffic it travels or is encapsulated at one particular VXLAN tunnel, and test traffic is encapsulated into another tunnel. But you can think about WebSocket, GTP, Genev, or any other tunneling protocol of your liking. The idea here is that the network layer should be able to look into VXLAN headers and should be able to differentiate normal traffic from test traffic to be able to impose this routing decision on traffic. But at the moment, a conventional layer 2 and layer 4 SDN switch does not have any way to distinguish VXLAN tunnels because they do not parse this layer of the protocol stack. For instance, the UDP port is always the same, so for a conventional SDN switch, these VXLAN tunnels just basically look the same. Again, the idea here is that VXLAN is a high-level protocol, and the network layer should be able to somehow get inside to this higher-layer network protocol to be able to implement some useful feature, which is in this particular example, canary deployment. A final example is policing RTP streams. So in this particular example, we have two RTP streams. User one, we want to rate limit their traffic at 10 kilobit per second, and the RTP stream of user two should be rate limited at 100 kilobit per second. Again, since the network layer does not parse RTP headers, RTP is an application layer protocol that is often used in the media plane. Therefore, there is no way to actually make this distinction in the infrastructure layer. Again, the rate limiting and the policing decisions must be engineered right into the microservices, and this makes it particularly difficult to change or alter them from a central SDN controller, which is usual in the SDN world. So this brings us to our second important takeaway. We argue that the application layer network functions and network policies should be moved out from the applications right into the SDN data plane, because this would allow us to enforce layer 7 network policies like load balancing, circuit breaking, health checking, request routing, L7 ACS, rate limitation, and the like from a central SDN controller. Of course, this idea is nothing new. In fact, if you are familiar with the trends in the cloud native community, you might be aware of this new hype in the cloud native world, which is called the service mesh. If you know what the service mesh is, it's cool, and if not, it's enough to say that the service mesh is basically a layer 7 SDN, so an application layer SDN that is built dedicated management infrastructure for handling HTTP-based microservice communication. The current model to implement the service mesh is what we could call the split mesh architecture, where the lower layer network policies are built into the network virtualization layer. In this case, these low-level network policies are managed by the orchestration platform. In this case, this is Kubernetes. While the application layer network policies are not just handled and enforced at a different point in the protocol stack, but also managed by a different control plane. In this particular example, it is Istio. The network virtualization layer controlled by Kubernetes, and the service proxy controlled by Istio together give the experience, the full stack SDN experience to the applications. Now, why this setup is problematic? The problem with the split stack architecture is that this basically enforces us to use a so-called sidecar proxy deployment model, where the layer 4, layer 7 network policies are implemented in the so-called service proxies that are injected by Istio alongside each application. So the idea is that we have a programmable HTTP proxy, which is Envoy in most of the cases. This proxy is injected into each application container, and then this proxy is programmed by the control plane so that it intercepts all ingress and egress communication to and from the application. This is beneficial from a number of reasons. First, the service proxy is the perfect way to encode layer 4 and layer 7 network policies and also enforce this on application traffic. The user space sidecar proxy model allows also allows for fast innovation in this application layer of the protocol stack. But the problem is that these service proxies need to implement all calls, and this basically means that performance-wise, this setup is less than optimal. So just think about a single local packet exchange between two applications deployed to a single server. What we see here is that even a local packet exchange requires stitching three TCP connections one after the other, which basically boils down to six kernel space to user space context switches. And remote calls are even worse in this setup. This is a well-known problem in the service mesh community, and lots of innovation is happening to preclude that. And in the paper, we present a couple of measurements and a couple of numbers. This show how this architecture takes a performance toll on particularly network-intensive workloads. This brings us to our third important takeaway, that the state-of-the-art application layer SDN model, the service mesh model, is unsatisfactory from a number of reasons. First, because it is restricted to HTTP, and second, because it runs on top of the inefficient sidecar proxy model. We believe that the source of the problem is the current split-stack approach that we are using in network virtualization. Namely, in the current model of network virtualization, the low-level network policies are enforced through the virtual switches, while the high-level network policies are enforced at a completely different and separate data plane element, the sidecar proxies. These data plane elements are managed by different control planes, and this split-stack architecture then naturally leads to inefficiencies and unnecessary complexity. So our proposal would be to move out the handling of high-level network policies from the sidecar proxies and move this functionality down into the virtual switches. This setup would then lead to the architecture, the unified architecture that we now call the full-stack SDN model, where the underlying virtual switch can provide network packet processing capabilities at any layer of the protocol stack, from the link layer all the way up into the application layer. This has full-stack approach has a number of advantages. In this particular setup, for instance, we immediately see that a local packet exchange now requires only just one simple connection instead of the stitching of three connections that we've seen in the previous slides. How to actually realize this full-stack SDN vision, it is currently not known. We only know that the requirement is there to be able to process packets at any layer in the protocol stack. We also believe that the traditional control plane data plane separation paradigm that we've seen to be highly successful in the SDN world should be maintained in the full stack model. But how to actually model the data plane, how to implement the control plane in the full stack model is currently pretty much an open problem and open for further research. There are a couple of vague ideas in the paper, but we believe that the full-stack SDN model hides ample opportunity for further research in the community. Finally, let's just quickly reiterate on how we got to this full-stack SDN challenge. We've seen that the transition of to the microservice architecture in cloud virtualization brings this interesting new development, that the main network communication pattern that we are seeing now in our networks is no longer layer 2 and layer 3 network policies, but shifts more and more towards the application layer that provide application specific communication functionality between microservices. Now, we also seen that in order to support these application layer network protocols, we should move out the corresponding functionality from the applications and build those into the SDN data plane, because then this would be possible to administer these layer 7 network policies from a central entity. But finally, we've also seen that the current way to actually doing that, the split stack architecture and the service mesh, is pretty much restricted in a number of ways and not really satisfactory for network-intensive workloads. We identified the split-stack model as the main culprit here, and we brought up the model of the full-stack SDN vision, where we unify all the layers processing of all the layers in the protocol stack into a single data plane element, and we called for further research in the area. And basically that's all. Thank you very much for the attention, and we are open to comments and questions in the comment area below.